Good day to everyone. Hope your day was full of last and blessing. My name is Janine Yupadayaw and I am your reporter in today's discussion. Together with Ma'am Ara Calunsag and Ma'am Sunshine Basagre, we hope that today, with our discussion, you will learn from us. And if ever you have some questions and clarifications, I'm here to answer that questions. After this video lesson, all of those questions will be answered. Now, I would like to introduce the given topic by our instructor, Sir John Recknoliao, which is the Chapter 5, Astronomical Instrument. In this chapter, our presentation is divided into telescope, telescope today, visible light detectors and instrument, radio telescope, observation outside Earth's atmosphere, and the future of the large telescope. To start, when you heard the word astronomical instrument, what comes to your mind? Yes, probably, it's telescope. Telescope is an optical instrument which is designed to make distant objects appear nearer, containing an arrangement of lenses or curved mirrors by which rays of light are collected and focused, wherein the resulting image is magnified. Before we proceed to our discussion, let me first discuss to you the learning objectives. By the end of the discussion, you will be able to, first, describe the three basic components of a modern system for measuring astronomical sources. Second, describe the main function of a telescope. And third, describe the two basic types of visible light telescopes and how they form images. There are three basic components of a modern system for measuring radiation from astronomical sources. First, the telescope. It serves as the bucket for collecting visible light or radiation at other wavelengths. Second, there is an instrument attached to the telescope that sorts the incoming radiation by wavelength, but sometimes the sorting is fairly crude. Third, we need some types of detector, a device that senses the radiation in the wavelength regions we have chosen and permanently records the observations. Let's come now to the history of the development of astronomical instrument. Many ancient cultures built special sites for observing the sky. We call it the ancient observatories. They measured the position of celestial objects, keep track of time and date. It also had religious and ritual functions as well. So during that time, tanging mata lang po ang ginagamit nila to gather the light and observe the sky. And also, the permanent record of observation na ginagawa nila is sinusulat lang nila or ini-sketch kung ano ang nakita nila sa sky using their hands and the paper. Until the year 1608, when Hans Lippershey, Zacharias Janssen, and Jacob Metius are all credited with the invention of telescope. Oh yes po, the year 1608, meron na po tayong telescope na nagamit nila to observe the sky. And then the year 1610, it was Galileo who used the first simple tube with lenses or spyglass to observe the sky and gather more light than his eye alone could. So that time po, ginamit po ni Galileo ang telescope para po i-observe ang sky and magather lahat ng light coming from it. Next, how telescope works. The most important function of telescope is first, to collect the faint light from the astronomical sources. Second, to focus all the light into a one point or an image. Most of object interest to astronomers are extremely faint. The more the light we can collect, the better we can study such object. So telescope collect visible radiations, use a lens or a mirror to gather the light. So other types of telescope use collecting devices that look very different from the lenses and mirrors which we are familiar but they serve as the same function. In all type of telescope, the light gathering ability is determined by the area of device acting as a light gathering bucket. Since most telescopes have mirror or lenses, we can compare their light gathering by comparing the apertures or diameter of opening through which light travels or reflects. Next, the formation of an image by a lens on a mirror. But first, what is lens? Lens is a transparent piece of material that bends the rays of light passing through it. As you can see in the image, if the curvatures of a lens surface are just right, all parallel rays of light are bent on or refracted in such a way that they converge toward a point called the focus of the lens. So, the distance from the lens to the location where the light rays focus or image behind the lens is called the focal length of lens. Next, eyepiece. It focuses the image at a distance that is either directly viewable by a human or at a convenient place for a detector. This additional lens can be used to change the magnification or the size of the image and redirect the light to the more accessible location. There are two types of telescope, the refracting telescope and reflecting telescope. But first, let me define the refractor word. A refractor is a design which uses a lens as its main optical element to form an image, and the telescope based on this design was called refracting telescope. Galileo's telescope is refractory, as are today binoculars are field glasses. A different type of a telescope uses a concave primary mirror as its main optical element. The mirror is curved like the inner surface of a sphere and it reflects the light in order to form an image. Reflecting telescope is a telescope uses a mirror rather than a lenses to form an image. In the year 1668, the first successful reflecting telescope was built by Isaac Newton. In reflecting telescope, the concave mirror is placed at the bottom of a tube or open framework. The mirror reflects the light back up the tube to form an image near the front and at the location. It was called the prime focus. Let's come now to the second part of my discussion, the telescopes today. Before we start our discussion, these are the learning objectives that we had. First, recognize the largest visible light and infrared telescopes in operation today. Second, discuss the factors relevant to choosing an appropriate telescope site. And third, define the techniques of adaptive optics and describe the effects of an atmosphere on astronomical observations. Since Newton's time, when the size of mirrors and telescopes were measured in inches, reflecting telescopes have grown ever larger. In the year 1948, U.S. astronomers built a telescope with a 5-meter, 200-inches diameter mirror on Palomar Mountain in Southern California. It remained the largest visible light telescope in the world for several decades. The giants of today, however, have primary mirrors, the largest mirrors in the telescope that are 8 to 10 meters in diameter, and larger ones are being built. The picture attached in this slide is the image shows one of the primary mirrors of an European Southern Observatory, very large telescope named Yepen. This is just after it was reacted with the aluminum. The mirror is little over 8 meters in diameter. Next, modern visible light and infrared telescopes. The decade starting in 1990 saw telescope building around the globe grow at unprecedented rate. Technological advancement had finally made it possible to build telescopes significantly larger than the 5-meter telescope at Palomar at a reasonable cost. New technologies have also been designed to work well in the infrared and not just visible wavelengths. So next, this table will show you the large single-dish visible light and infrared telescope. It's composed of 16 telescopes with their aperture, location, and their status. For example, large single-dish visible light and infrared telescope, I chosen or pick these two telescopes, the Palomar Telescope and modern Gemini North Telescope. I will give their differences. Palomar Telescope is a massive steel structure designed to hold the 14.5-ton primary mirror with a 5-meter diameter. Glass tends to sag under its own weight, hence a huge steel structure is needed to add the mirror. While Gemini North Telescope, this telescope looks like a featherweight by construct, and indeed it is. The mirror is only about 8 inches thick and weighs 24.5 tons, less than twice as much as Palomar mirror. Gemini mirror does not sag, but with modern computers, it is possible to measure that sag many times each second and apply forces at 120 different locations to the back of the mirror to correct the sag. The process is called active control. Gemini telescope is completed about 2 years after the Palomar telescope built. There are 17 telescopes with mirrors of 6.5 meters in diameter, and larger have been constructed since 1990. Another one is the Keck telescope. The twin 10-meter Keck telescope on Mauna Kea is the first new technology instrument that uses precession control in an entirely novel way. Instead of a single primary mirror, 10 meters in diameter, each Keck telescope achieves its larger aperture by combining the light from 36 separate hexagonal mirrors, each 1.8 meters wide. Computer-controlled actuators or motors constantly adjust these 36 mirrors so that the overall reflecting surfaces acts like a single mirror with just the right shape to collect and focus the light into a sharp image. That's why 36 eyes are better than one. Let's come now to the Voyagers and astronomy. George Ellery Hale is a master telescope builder from the year 1868 to 1938. He was a giant among early telescope builders. Not once, but four times, he initiated projects that led to the construction of what was world's largest telescope at the time. And he was a master at winning over world benefactors to underwrite the constructions of this new instrument. Hale's work led to the construction of several major telescopes, including the 40-inch refracting telescope at Yerkes Observatory, and three reflecting telescopes, the 60-inch Hale and the 100-inch Hooker telescope at Mount Wilson Observatory, and the 200-inch Hale telescope at Palomar Observatory. There are four relevant factors in choosing or picking the best observing site. First is the most obvious limitation is the weather condition, such as clouds, wind, and rain. At the best site, the weather is clear as much as 75% of the time. Second, even on a clear night, the atmosphere filters out a certain amount of starlight, especially in the infrared, which the absorption is due to primarily to water vapor. But astronomers therefore prepare dry sites, generally found at the high altitudes. Third is the sky above the telescope should be dark. Near cities, there is this effect, light pollution, wherein the air scatters the glare from the lights, producing an illumination that hides the faintest stars and limits the distances that can be proved by the telescope. Observatories are best located at least 100 miles from the nearest large city. And the last one, finally, the air is often unsteady. Light passing through this turbulent air is disturbed, resulting in a blurred star images. Astronomers call these effects as bad seeing. When seeing is bad, images of a celestial object are distorted by the constant twisting and bending of the light rays by the turbulent air. Therefore, the best observatory sites are in the high, dark, and dry places. The resolution of a telescope. Resolution refers to the precision of a detail present in an image that is the smallest features that can be distinguished. One factor that determines how good the resolution will be is the size of the telescope. Larger apertures produces sharper images. But the problem is, our planet's atmosphere is turbulent. It contains many small-scale blobs of cells of gas that range in size from inches to several feet. Each cell has slightly different temperature from its neighbor, and each cell acts like a lens, bending or refracting the path of the light by a small amount. Because of this slightly bending, it changes the position where each light ray finally reaches the detector and the telescope. Let's say, for example, you are watching a parade from a window high up in the scraper, and you decided to throw some confetti down toward the marchers, and even if you drop a handful all of the same time and in the same direction, air currents will toss these pieces around that they will reach the ground at different places. As we described earlier, we can think of a light from the stars as a series of parallel beams, each making its way through the atmosphere. Each path will be slightly different and each will be reach the detector of the telescope at a slightly different place. The result of this is a blurred images. And because the cells are being blown by the wind, the nature of the blur will change many times each second. You probably noticed this effect as a twinkling of the stars seen from the Earth. The resolution of an image is measured in units of an angle on the sky, typically in units of arc seconds. One arc second is 1 over 3600 degrees, and there are 360 degrees in a full circle. So we are talking about the tiny angles on the sky. One of the main reasons for launching the Hubble Space Telescope was to escape the Earth's atmosphere and obtain even sharper images. Adaptive optics. These techniques, which is the most effective in the infrared region of the spectrum with our current technology. It makes use of a small, flexible mirror placed in the beam of a telescope. With adaptive optics, ground-based telescope can achieve resolution of 0.1 arc second or a little better in infrared region of the spectrum. This impressive figure is the equivalent of the resolution that the Hubble telescope achieves in the visible light region of the spectrum. And that's conclude my discussion about telescopes and telescopes today. Thank you for listening. Hope you learned something about my discussion. And now may I call on my groupmates to discuss the remaining topic of Chapter 5, Astronomical Instrument.